And thank you very much for the invitation. Hopefully I can live up to that introduction. So before I start, I want to make sure that all of the people who have done a lot of the work for the studies that I'm going to talk about get the right acknowledgement. So in my lab in Texas, CJ and Aliu have worked a lot on the Vivax work that I'm going to present. And prior to them, Simon and Stanwell worked extensively on the Malawian PFAS ciparum data that we'll present. We get extraordinary amounts of support from Tim's lab, specifically Charlene Nair helped develop some of the early approaches that I'll describe. Francois in Thailand is always an incredible font of knowledge and samples and studies for our Vivax collaboration. I'll talk a little bit about some ongoing work we have with generating genetic crosses in malaria parasites, which is a collaboration between Mike Ferdig's lab at University of Notre Dame and Ashley Bourne and Stefan Kappa at Seattle Children's Hospital. And of course, we are funded by a variety of mechanisms, notably NIH for this work. So very, very broadly, I'm going to go through the single cell genomics platform that we have developed and why we have developed this, and delve a little bit into how we are using this to understand relatedness within infections, and finish off with understanding the evolution of parasites within infections and our approaches to identify de novo mutations arising within individual infections. Assuming I run to time, I will also discuss a little bit about the ongoing work with genetic crosses in humanized mice. So I'm sure that I do not need to spell out for this audience just how critical malaria research is. In 2015, approximately 400,000 malaria deaths occurred. In recent years, despite year-on-year declines in malaria deaths since the turn of the century, we're starting to stagnate in terms of the number of the reduction in the number of malaria deaths each year. So there is clearly still a lot of work that needs to be done to control malaria and to understand its spread. So I'm going to very quickly go over the life cycle. This is going to come up a number of times throughout the talk, so I'm going to just spend a couple of moments going through. So the life cycle begins when an infected mosquito bites an individual. They inject sporozoite stages into the bloodstream. These migrate to the liver, where they invade liver cells, and they develop within liver cells, and each liver cell that gets infected by a single sporozoite can have about 50,000 parasites within it that will burst out of the liver and start to invade the bloodstream. So critically, this stage is also where the hypnozoite reservoir for P. vivax occurs. So the hypnozoite reservoir are cells, parasites that lay dormant in the liver and can stay there for months to years and then reactivate and burst out of the liver and cause secondary infections for this patient. So once parasites burst out of the liver, they cycle through the intraerythrocytic developmental cycle. This starts with the ring stages, where you have a single parasite, single haploid parasite within a cell. There is extensive remodeling that develops, the parasite develops into trophozoites and then schizonts, where you have approximately 16-ish copies of the parasite genome in that cell. These burst out, merozoite stage parasites burst out, and each single merozoite will invade another uninfected red blood cell. This is the stage where we see the vast majority of clinical symptoms. It's the stage where the vast majority of drugs and vaccines are targeted to, although not universally. So at some point, a small subset of these cycling parasites will commit to gametocytogenesis. They will differentiate into either male or female gametes. They will get uptaken by a mosquito. Males will exflagellate. They will fuse, and sexual recombination between the male and female gametes will occur. This allows genetic recombination. This is also the only stage in a parasite life cycle where you have diploid present. After this recombination has occurred, they will develop through oocyst stage, migrate to the mosquito salivary glands, and be ready as sporozoites for injection into the next patient. So there is extraordinary variation across this life cycle in terms of the absolute numbers of parasites that are present at any given stage. So in these early liver stages, approximately 10 to the 4 parasites, these burst out, and there is an extraordinary amplification of numbers of parasites in the bloodstream. In falciparum, this reaches around 10 to the 11, 10 to the 12, lower for P. vivax. And then a subset, around 1% of the blood stage parasites will be gametocytes. Mosquitoes are a lot smaller than humans, and only a small number of parasites are transmitted during a mosquito blood meal. And then the absolute kind of nadir here is oocysts. There is approximately kind of 1 to sometimes 60 or so oocysts per mosquito in midgut, and then there is expansion, and then we sort of come around the life cycle here. So these bottlenecks may have and should have an extreme impact on the genetic diversity of a parasite. So I'll go through this. This is not working. So there are three scenarios that we will explore a little bit through here. The first is a monoinfection, where a genetically monomorphic infection within a mosquito is transmitted to an individual, and then this individual has just one single parasite genotype in their bloodstream. When it comes to superinfection, two mosquitoes will independently bite a person, each of these bearing a genetically distinct strain or lineage of parasites, and both of these will cause infection in this individual. And in the final scenario is co-transmission, where a mosquito has bitten an infected individual that had an infection that looks like, I'm highlighting the wrong screen here. Can everyone see my pointer? Yes?
Now again, yes.
Excellent, sorry. So an infection that looks like this one here, and there will be genetic recombination in the mosquito midgut, and the progeny that are go on to cause that infection will be a mixture of probably parental genotypes and recombination of those parental genotypes. So these will be related to one another. So complexity of infection, where you see what would you loosely define as the number of genetically distinct parasites that are within an infection, varies hugely across a range of malaria transmission intensities. So at very low transmission intensity, the vast majority of individuals are uninfected, and those that are infected tend to be infected by one single parasite genotype. There is also not an incredible amount of genetic diversity in the population at large. At higher levels of transmission, it is still rare to see individuals who are infected by more than one parasite genotype, but there is a larger amount of genetic diversity. And in the high transmission regions, which we study predominantly, the vast majority of people are infected, and the vast majority of people are infected by more than one parasite genotype. So these numbers are perhaps slightly out of date now, but the Complex infections where you see more than one parasite genotype within an infection are extraordinarily common in sub-Saharan Africa, with up to 80% of infections containing more than one parasite genotype. If you want to have genetic recombination between distinct parasites, you need to have different genotypes taken up by the mosquito. So complex infections are typically required for outcrossing, though things such as interrupted biting, where a mosquito will feed on one individual, get interrupted and go to a second individual, should also contribute towards outcrossing as well. They make genetic analysis incredibly challenging to do. It's not really possible to understand which phenotype goes with which genotype within an infection when you have this mixture of different genotypes within an infection. It's very difficult, based on kind of genome sequencing alone, to understand the genome sequence of any individual parasite within an infection. And there is some evidence that mechanisms such as competition between different parasite genotypes may drive the outcome of an infection, but this has predominantly only been observed in mouse malaria infections. They haven't really had the tools to explore this in detail in human infections. So how do you look at mixed clone infections? Traditionally, people have used genotyping of highly polymorphic markers like MSP1. You can see from this gel, which is not a very clear gel, that it's sometimes quite ambiguous determining whether or not you have two bands, such as this one here, or one band. And multiple bands would indicate, in this case, multiple parasite genotypes. In the era of kind of genome sequencing, we have essentially the same ability to identify mixed clone infections, but on steroids, where we have essentially all the markers in the genome, but actually distinguishing which of these genotypes go together in the same parasite genome is still incredibly difficult. So several years ago, myself and Charlie Nair decided to see if there was a way of using single-cell genotyping or single-cell genome sequencing to genotype individual haplotypes from an infection. So this led us to develop a single-cell genotyping platform. So what we do here, we take red blood cells from a malaria parasite infection. These are cryopreserved, shipped to our lab in Texas. We incubate these with a live cell dye and perform flow cytometry to pull out the infected cells. One really nice feature of working with malaria parasites, they live in red blood cells that lack nuclei. So you can very easily just look at red blood cells that have nuclei, and those are the ones that are parasites. So identifying infected red blood cells is quite trivial. We sort single cells into single tubes, and then under incredibly sterile conditions, we amplify up these genomes using multiple strand displacement amplification and perform either genome sequencing, or originally we did genotyping. So over the last few years, there's been a number of kind of methodological innovations that we've developed that have really improved the quality of our data. These started with Charlene really being incredibly cautious and careful about the sterility of our approaches. And this led to us developing or changing our lab airflow system so that we had areas of the lab that were completely distinct and separate from the rest that we could do good kind of clean room practices with. She serendipitously discovered that freeze-thawing the parasites made an extraordinary difference on the data quality. Simon took over this project from Sharni and did two major innovations. The first of these was just improving quality control of reagents. And the second was to target late stage parasites. I'll go into this in the next slide. And CJ and Ali have since taken this protocol and adapted it for low parasitemia infections, such as asymptomatic P. falciparum and P. vivax infections. So when Simon joined my lab, he was excited by some of the cancer literature that said you could get much, much higher quality single cell sequencing data by targeting parasites that are dividing. So this is our flow cytometry plot. We have uninflected red cells. This is increasing amounts of DNA as you move to the right. And if you look at, we have three broad gates here. These are ring stage parasites that bear a single copy of the parasite genome. These are trophozoite stage parasites that have kind of 2 to 4 copies of the genome. And this high gate in the end has more than 4, perhaps as many as kind of 16 or 18 copies of the parasite genome. And we've done flow sorting of each of these gates to kind of morphologically show that these are what we think they are. So very broadly, if we sort ring stage parasites and sequence those genomes, we get about a random 50% of the genome. If we sort trophozoite stages, we get up to kind of 80% of the parasite genome that we get sequence data back from. But with Cheeseman stages, we're approaching the level where this is almost indistinguishable in terms of coverage of the genome from bulk genome sequencing. The innovation that CJ and Aliu made was to take to add one additional step into this protocol, and then once we have thawed these infections, we wait approximately 40 hours for later stage parasites to develop, and we do magnetic purification. One feature of the parasite genome is throughout its life cycle, it metabolizes hemoglobin, and the iron that is present in hemoglobin oxidizes, and the parasites become a little bit more magnetic. So purifying out late stage parasites by using kind of these high powered magnets is quite a simple way of enriching for late stage parasites. And then we, once we've enriched the parasitema a little bit, we can carry on with our flow cytometry and amplify and sequence the genomes of these parasites. So with this low parasitemia single cell sequencing protocol, we also find that the data is incredibly pure. We don't get mixtures between different parasite genotypes that were present in a single infection. Okay, so I'm going to move on to talk about some of the actual data that we generated from infections. Our first study was based in Chikwawa, Malawi. It's a relatively high infection area. There is approximately one infectious bite per individual every couple of days. So the chances of being super infected by many different parasite strains is in theory quite high. So we wanted to go to this area and look to see what is the genetic makeup of the infections that we find in Malawi. This is a picture of Stamel out engaging villages in the Chikwawa district and getting the study explained back to all of the participants, and also having a disco and giving away t-shirts, which is very well received. So the first thing that we did, we took 50 symptomatic individuals from the 2016 malaria season, and we did bulk genome sequencing of all of these parasites. So this FWS metric shows the broadly captures whether or not this infection was complicated, it had more than one genotype or not. Above this line here, these infections are thought to be monomorphic, only bearing a single parasite strain. So because single cell sequencing is quite laborious, we focused most of our efforts on the infections that we thought were more complex. But we included a small number of seemingly monomorphic infections to see if there were missed genotypes in those infections. There were not. So for each infection, we targeted 15 of these 50 parasite genomes, 50 infections for single cell sequencing. And we processed cells in batches of 24. So we would isolate 24 cells from this infection, perform genome sequencing on those 24 cells. And if we feel we had not captured enough of the genetic diversity, we would keep sequencing more and more cells until we stopped discovering new strains. So what did we find? This is a comparison of what you can infer from bulk genome sequencing to what you can infer from single cell sequencing. So on the left here, the inferred number of infections kind of ranges from kind of 2 to perhaps 5. Whereas by single cell sequencing data, it ranges from kind of 1 or 2 up to 17, which is an incredibly diverse infection. How within infections, we can also look to see how related are the parasites within each of these infections. To our surprise, even in very genetically diverse infections, almost all of the parasites were related in some way to one another. And this is captured by this network plot where you can see each dot is one parasite genome from an infection. And they are colored according to the infection that we're in. The black dots are from from bulk monoclonal infections. And you can see that there are very few instances where we see parasites that are not joined by lines to each other that are from the same infection. So for instance, this MAL48 infection has two genomes over here and then a bunch of genomes over here. So these parasites are not related to one another, and most likely some kind of super infection event led to the genetic diversity of that infection.
Ian?
Yes, John.
How are you defining relatedness? What's your threshold for considering relatedness?
So we define relatedness in a few different ways. And I think I'm going to come back through and talk about our IBD metrics in the next few slides. And if that doesn't
answer
the question,
yeah, that's
maybe,
okay.
I can rephrase it. In fact, all right, yes. So if I will jump straight into IBD. So this is a very kind of broad schematic of what would happen in a mosquito. So these black lines are parasite genomes, the colors represent genotypes. So these two parasites that are mating here are genetically identical to one another. This is a selfing event. And the offspring are 100% identical by descent to each other, or IBD. In this mosquito, there are two completely distinct parasite genotypes. When they mate, their genomes will be shuffled up, and each of these offspring will be 50% identical by descent to each other. And identity by descent decreases with each round of meiosis. So if this parasite went on to mate with this one and this mated with some other parasite, their offspring would be less related to one another than these siblings. So within a single infection, we see a very broad range of these metrics of relatedness. So this total amount of IBD, I beg your pardon, the parasite genome is about 23 megabases. I realize if I pointed my finger, you can't see that. The parasite genome is about 23 megabases long. So this group of parasites at the top here are all clonally identical to one another. They share 23 megabases of their genome with each other. This is pairwise comparison. So this dot is the comparison of the amount of IBD shared between two parasites. And this cloud down here, this is where approximately 50% of the parasite genome is shared. And these are full or half SIBs. And then there is this cloud of parasites that share some degree of relatedness. They share some large blocks of IBD, but they are not siblings. They may be more distant relatives, such as kind of nephew, uncle, or second cousins, or something more further distant. And then there is a cloud at the bottom of parasites that essentially share little to no IBD. So within a single, and this is the range of relatedness within a single infection. Joanna, does this answer your question?
I guess my question goes to the, where do you draw the line of the little to no IBD?
Yes, it's based upon the...
is your threshold at 3%, 5% IBD?
It depends on the population. So we derive that from the amount of IBD that is shared on average among parasites from different infections. So anything that we see, from monoclonal infections from different patients, they will share some degree of IBD by chance or population structure. And that is the threshold at which we say anything that is above that is more related than what you would expect by chance. So very broadly, we can classify these infections into monoclonal infections, where we only saw one parasite genotype despite delving extraordinarily deeply. We saw quite rarely only in one instance of a very simple super infection where we saw two parasite genotypes that bore no relatedness to one another. Co-transmission was the dominant feature here, where most parasites in polyclonal infections show relatedness to one another and very, very likely came from the same infection. And then in some instances, we saw both processes operating simultaneously, where we saw relatedness among some group of parasites, but also no IBD sharing between another group of parasites within the same infection. So this really suggests that these extreme bottlenecks through the parasite life cycle are not completely obliterating genetic diversity. There is still an extraordinary amount of genetic diversity that is maintained across this life cycle and passed from patient to patient. For instance, the patient that we saw that had 17 distinct parasite genotypes, all of those genotypes were related to one another and likely came from the bite of a single infected mosquito. So we can start to probe this data a little bit more deeply and start to ask, how many oocysts do we expect gave rise to an infection from a single mosquito? So most, this is data from Malawi. And this is the number of oocysts that were observed in mosquito midgut. So the mode is one. Most mosquitoes have one oocyst per midgut. But there is extraordinary variation. You can have up to kind of 60 oocysts per midgut. So the potential for that's up to 60 times 4, 240 different parasite genotypes could, in theory, come out of that mosquito. So we looked at the, we tried to reconstruct parasites that came from the same oocyst from our data and saw that we were able to do that with varying degrees of success. And from that, we can work out the number of oocysts that were present in that mosquito or likely present in that mosquito that gave rise to an infection. And this is what we found. So this is the tetrads reconstruction that we did. So this is based off of single cell data that we derived from a single patient. We were able to find the four products of a single meiosis and then infer what the parental genotypes of this parasite were. And by doing that, we discovered some nice interesting features of this infection. We saw signatures of inbreeding, where these parasites were, the parents of these parasites were related to one another. And we can see this by a kind of a complete obliteration of genetic diversity on chromosome 8 and a chunk of chromosome 9. We also found some signatures of non-Mendelian inheritance, where there was not equal segregation of the genotypes at a given region. You expect there to be each of the parental alleles to be present in two of the offspring. But in this chunk here, we saw a whole region where one of the parental alleles was only present in one copy. And then similarly, but a much shorter chunk up on chromosome 2 as well. So overall, we feel that a model of kind of serial transmission, even in very high transmission areas, is driving the complexity of infection in these regions. So I'm going to move on. I'm running out of time. Not very good. So I'm going to move on to our work in Thailand, which is much more contemporary work. So we teamed up with Francois Nostin to look at recurrent Plasmodium vivax infections in Mae Sot in Thailand. So here we have, if you recall from the introduction, P. vivax has hypnozoite stage parasites, which may relapse later in a person's life to give rise to secondary infections. So this means when somebody has a second bout of P. vivax malaria, this may have been from parasites that were already resident in the liver. It may be from parasites that were from a fresh mosquito bite, or it may be from parasites that were just went down to a very low undetectable level in the parasite in the patient's bloodstream and then re-emerged to cause an infection. It's called recrudescence. So we took 11 patients where we had two time points, a primary and a secondary infection, and performed single cell sequencing of each of these parasites. We targeted 24 cells from each infection because of the very low parasitemias of vivax infections. Our success rate was lower than P. falciparum, but we still got quite deep coverage of a lot of these infections. Similarly to high transmission regions of Plasmodium falciparum, we saw that both within and across infection time points, the vast majority of infections are related. But what we were really excited by this data was trying to identify mutations that were arising within single infections. And I'm going to jump into this work because I think this is the most exciting part of my presentation, I hope. De novo mutations, so mutation very broadly is the raw material for evolution. So fundamental to the emergence of traits like drug resistance or vaccine escape or virulence, ones that we are very interested in for malaria, for understanding the biology of malaria. Phylogenetic analysis can recapitulate the evolutionary history of these parasites. Then it will tell you how long they have been in an individual patient. However, single cell sequencing is somewhat noisy. It requires additional validation when you are trying to identify de novo mutations. So we performed an in vitro experiment where we took the 3D7 line of Plasmodium falciparum. We grew this for about 150 days. If we are able to identify de novo mutations, we should see more de novo mutations close to 150 days than we do close to about 50 days through this experiment. So we sorted single cells at around day 50 and single cells at, I think, day 140, and looked to see if we were accruing mutations in that culture. And indeed we were. We saw very few mutations at around day 56, but we saw quite a lot of mutations at day 140. Very, very excitingly, we saw a few mutations that seemed to be under selection that were being swept through that in vitro culture, one in the ursus rupture protein and one in a conserved protein. But essentially, this shows that we're able to use single cell sequencing to identify de novo mutations that are emerging in the parasite genome. So when we look at Plasmodium vivax, we don't have the ability to grow this long term. It's not a parasite which you can do in vitro culture. You can do very short term ex vivo culture. So we took parasites that were clones of each other that share 100% of their genome IBD. Within each of these groups of clonally identical parasite, we searched for SNPs that distinguish those two genotypes. And then we went in and did very kind of careful examination of each of those genotypes by looking at the read pileups, and saw a large amount of technical false positives that we're able to weed out through this way. And you can see that this is quite easy to see. We see in cell one, 100% of the reads very, very cleanly support a G at this position. In cell two, none of them do. And this would be a valid SNP by our criteria. And for this other SNP, we see very inconsistent patterns of coverage for this SNP. And this is most likely a false positive. And it's very powerful when we look at kind of multiple cells simultaneously, because if we see kind of spurious patterns in one cell, it's kind of indicative that we may have a false positive in a different cell. So across the P. vivax genome, we identified around 1,000 de novo mutations using this approach. After visual inspection, we saw that 321 of these were technical false positives. We also saw a large number of these, clustered into short regions of the parasite genome. I should say that our analysis also excludes a lot of the hypervariable regions of the genome that give spurious results because they're quite challenging to align to anyway. But these short chunks of the genome, we think are likely due to cryptic relatedness, where you have two parasites that are highly inbred with one another over time, and they are not genuine de novo mutations. But after a lot of this filtering, we got down to 292 de novo mutations scattered through the parasite genome. So what do they do? Oh, because we have paired infections here, which span multiple time points, we're able to test whether or not these likely arose during the hypnozoite stage, which is broadly thought to be a dormant stage, or whether or not mutation accrues to some extent in the hypnozoite. So we have identical parasites that were present at this time point one, and also weeks to months later at time point two, and we would expect to see these TP2 mutations to have acquired more mutations if there is mutation in the hypnozoite stage. We did not. We saw absolutely no correlation between the length of time between an infection and the number of mutations that TP2 had accrued. And actually, we only saw one instance where a secondary time point had accrued mutations that were fixed among all of the cells in that infection. And these are those cells, and you can see there's very consistent patterns. So this is 3 of 24 cells that bore the genotypes here, and 3 of 24 cells, but it was incredibly consistent and clear across all of those projects. So we're really interested to know whether or not these de novo mutations are being seen by selection within the body, whether they may be adaptive to the parasite, whether they may influence pathology in some sense. We are not at the level at which we can definitively answer that question, but we do have some, I think, compelling data that suggests that there is selection happening on these de novo mutations. There was an excess of non-synonymous mutations and premature stop mutations in the data. We saw the same genes impacted by recurrent mutation across different infections. And of these, and we also saw specific categories of genes that were disproportionately impacted by de novo mutation. So these were the APAP2 family of transcription factors, where 5 of the 24 members of this family have accrued a mutation of some kind. So previous work by other groups have also shown various members of the APAP2 gene family are under positive selection. This is quite exciting to us. So we wanted to take this further and look back at our PFAS-CIPRM data. Using exactly the same approaches, we identified 246 de novo mutations after filtering out those that we felt were due to false positives or cryptic relatedness. These fell, 150 of these fell into coding regions, and 11 genes were recurrently impacted, of which there was a very clear pattern of translation factor activity being under recurrent mutation. You see a lot of eukaryotic translation initiation factors and elongation factors. So we looked to see whether or not there was any evidence that genes that were impacted by de novo mutations in PFAS-CIPRM, whether their homolog in P. vivax was also impacted by de novo mutation. This might suggest some kind of convergent evolution across species, across infections. And indeed, we found 5 genes where both homologs were impacted by mutation in species that have been separated for quite some time. This included the elongation factor G, and this impacts almost the same domain of that gene, and also an APAP2 transcription factor. And this is limiting to potentially functional mutations as well, either non-synonymous mutations or premature stop codons. So I will skip through these conclusions very quickly. We have a single cell platform that we think is quite powerful for understanding intra-host relatedness, the difference between superinfection, co-transmission, and for identifying de novo mutations. And we think that there is a good evidence that looking at de novo mutations is identifying things that are being selected within infections. So I'm going to very, very briefly talk about, in just 2 minutes, talk about the collaborative cross program that we have going with Seattle Children's and Notre Dame. So it has been very, very challenging to do genetic crosses in a controlled way in malaria infections. This is because it requires splenectomized chimpanzees. It is actually no longer possible at all because chimpanzees are no longer used for biomedical research. So Ashley Vaughan and his team tested whether or not we could replace using chimpanzees with humanized mice. And they put out this very nice paper where we're able to do controlled genetic crosses in malaria parasites using these humanized mice. So we are now in the process of kind of ramping up and doing this at a big scale. So we're using two approaches. The first is doing classical linkage mapping where we identify recombinant progeny, we pull them out, we do phenotyping, and we can do QTL mapping to determine which genes are driving which phenotype. This is extremely laborious and very difficult, but very robust. We're also using an approach called bulk segregant analysis, where we basically take a big pool of recombinant progeny, place them under a selection like drug pressure, and then look to see what the change in frequency of genes is under selection, and use that to map traits of interest. This is an approach, bulk segregant analysis, that has been used in rodent malaria in the past, and also yeast and worm studies, and is and also schistosome parasites. So when we look in the crosses that we have done to date, we have really been able to boost up the power of classical parasite genetics. We've generated 3 new crosses to date. NF54, the parent of the canonical reference strain, versus a new Thai parasite called NHP4026. a cross between two recently derived Thai isolates. What is not on this is a cross between a Malawian isolate and a Cambodian isolate that we're going to use to map artemisinin drug resistance. And there are some interesting things that come out of this. We do not see even inheritance of both parental alleles in the progeny of these parasites. We see, for instance, PFCRT mutations, which drive chloroquine resistance, are hugely underrepresented, and various other mutations as well, such as MRP2 and ARP10S, that have also been linked to drug resistance, are skewed as well. Also, genes involved with invasion of red blood cells. So we have gone from having tens of parasites that we can use for genetic mapping to now we almost have 200 from this cross. And we have, for the cross that is not on this slide, though is here, we have now approaching, I think, 200 from this genetic cross as well. And we see complementary patterns of skewing in these crosses. So the idea here is we're going to ramp up and do an extraordinary amount of QTL mapping across these genetic cross progeny. And I'm going to skip the last few slides because I realize I'm overrunning.